How's it going, my good friends? In this video, I want to do something a little bit more relaxing and calm and like smooth and stuff like that. I got a little bit of cold, so that's why I've decided I will sit down and paint some still life of, tools and stuff that I have in the shop. And I hope you enjoy this one. It's going to be, more relaxing and soothing, maybe, hopefully. So let's get to it. Okay, so we've got all our setup right and ready. I have the canvas, which is just a piece of board which I've laid a layer of gesso, but I want to darken it a little bit because it's a bit too bright for the background. So I will use some burnt sienna and we'll move forward after that. I begin by laying out some outlines of my objects, just so I have a rough idea of where I need to put the color. I'm still using some burnt sienna and burnt amber for that, as it gives me a nice warm background to the painting. Okay, this is the rough sketch. I know it's fantastic, but let's continue and block the background, and then we'll get a nicer picture of what is what, because now it's a bit confusing. For the background, I'm using mostly ultramarine blue and some black. I'm not going to great details to get all the fabric done, because it just needs the purpose of the contrast for the subjects of the picture. So I begin with painting the handle of the saw, which I found the most complex shape, and it's the only one that I've used a slightly different technique than the rest of the painting, which is I first paint an undercoat of black and white for the shadows and the highlights, and I glaze some color over it. This is to help me get the values correctly and the dynamics of the hand, because the hand is quite a complex shape. But for the rest of the painting, I use what you can say my regular technique, and I would actually not recommend trying to copy immediately how I paint, because I would say that I paint quite impatiently, and what I mean by that is that I don't take the time to really mix in the perfect color and the perfect values or tones of the colors before I lay them on the painting. And so the only way that I can categorize my technique is that I fix a lot. It's a fixing painting. I put some colors and values and I fix it until it looks right to me. And that can be an advantage and a disadvantage. The disadvantage is that many, many colors can lose depth. They become very milky, they become very pale and very grayish, and they lose their depth to it, and which is something that I need to try and fix later. The advantage, and what I like to paint like this, is that you have a really nice flow of working, even though it can many times take much longer to paint this way. But benefit that I like is that I like the dirty look. And what I mean by that, every part of the painting, or at least most of it, holds a lot of information, a lot of different colors, and every brush stroke is not exactly the color, like flat color, that exists in reality, because or how it looks like in reality, because I feel like everything possesses a lot of colors, and the dirty look is something that feels more real to me and more interesting looking. So I hope that's clear. But this is the way I like to do things. Moving on to the actual pigeon, which in the still life itself is just a cardboard, but I put a small reference in my phone just to get a few ideas of how the pigeon looks like. And I went for a white pigeon, basically a dove, I guess, because it more complements the composition of the colors and the background and all of that. I think a gray pigeon, which I like better, would be a little bit too much for all the colors that are going on. The pigeon was really, really fun to make, and I didn't do a lot of corrections with the pigeon because I liked how it looked and I kept it there. It has a lot of, you can call mistakes in terms of realism, but I liked how it looked, so I went with it. The most difficult part of the painting, in my opinion, was the saw blade, the metal portion. And I think I struggled with that because I tried to cover it up very, very quickly. And because it's reflective enough to look like metal, but it's not as reflective to really just paint all the colors that is around it, it was quite difficult to make it look realistic. And that's why, as you can see, I went and added the lemon, which is kind of cheating because I put it there only to reflect it on the saw, which helped a lot to give the blade metallic look and reflective look. And you'll see in a moment where I put the reflection, and this really, really helped the saw come to life. Moving on, I went to paint the hammer, which was also very, very fun because the hammer is, even though it's very, very small, it has a lot of different colors and values in it. And I start with a little bit of grayish colors and slowly but surely add warmer colors that reflect the surroundings. And basically, I love highlights. Highlights is always the easiest but can be deceiving way to get something look realistic. And the hammer has just loads of highlights, and it really, really is fun to do. Now I'm going back to the saw portion and mostly the spine. I really didn't look right. I rushed it out a little bit. And so I went back and I had a little bit of different lighting at this point. So there was much more golden reflection, golden colors coming out from the back. So, and I didn't put too much effort there. I think just to represent was good enough. Now, I really love painting screwheads because of the round shape of them, they basically collect all the colors of the painting into one tiny, tiny spot. And in the beginning, it looks just like a mess, like a soup of colors, and it doesn't make any sense. But then you just put a hint of golden highlight, and you take a step back, and it all of a sudden transforms to a screwhead or brass button or whatever. And that's why I love it so much. It's really fun to do. So now I went back to paint the parsley again. This was a bit of a challenge, as I didn't want to spend time and break my head over every leaf and every details, because the parsley really has many, many leaves, and there's no point in painting each individual because it will just break the painting. So you need to kind of represent the general blur of the parsley and the leaves, get just the tones and the values and then the colors right. And then just give a few hints of the stems and just basically where the highlights break, and they give a nice detail and enough information for your brain to think, okay, that's leaves, I can see that. I think I was quite happy in the end how it looked. Now, this is one of my favorite parts, is to put varnish, a few coats of varnish on the final dried painting. The thing is, with acrylic paint and also with oil paint, it really depends. They dry to a kind of a matte sheen, and they kind of lose a little bit of saturation and become a little bit grayish. And so the varnish really helps bring them back to the way you've seen them when you lay them on the board, on the canvas, because you use them wet to begin with. And it really brings the painting back into life and back to the full colors that I originally saw when I painted it. So my friends, I hope you enjoy this one. I'm really happy to go back and do some more painting. I haven't done that in quite a while, and I really should try and paint more often and on a regular basis, because it really helps with perceiving things and looking at things, and not just in paintings, but in other crafts and things like that. So I hope you enjoyed this video, and I will see you in the next video. So, see you later.